Hello, my name is Eric Siepen, and I am one of the pastors at the Village Church. The following podcast is a ministry of the Village Church. We hope that it inspires you, that it draws you closer to Jesus, and it opens your eyes to the possibilities of living in the kingdom. Enjoy, and God bless.
Good to be with you. Oh, man. I got water in my Bible. It's all right. There's also a giant coffee stain on it, so I don't... It's all right. It's like 14 years old. It's great. Let's pray. Jesus, thank you for today. Thank you for the love that you have for us. Thank you for the opportunity to come together to worship you, to read your word. Would you give us hope in you, peace, joy, and may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and redeemer. Amen. Amen. All right, so we are in John chapter 15. We've been in a series on John. If you've been here for a bit, you probably know that because we've been doing it for like 6 months now. It's great. We've still got a little ways to go, but we've talked through Jesus's ministry, and then in John chapter 11, Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead, and that's a turning point in his ministry. Then we go straight from there into the last week of Jesus's life, and the rest of John is all about the last week of Jesus' life. So we've covered his triumphal entry into Jerusalem, the Last Supper, and then he sent Judas out to go betray him. And then he has some things to tell his disciples. So he begins to teach them, to talk to them about some different stuff. And then my mic cut out, so I got sidetracked. And then last week, at the end of the passage last week, it said, "And come, let us go now." So we know that they got up, they went out to the garden and in to pray. And in the garden, Jesus continues talking to them about the vine and the branches. So we're going to talk about this. We're going to talk about the vine and the branches, the seventh I am statement in John. We're going to talk about God's love and what that looks like. We're going to talk about how everyone hates us. It's going to be great. Sound good? All right. So before we get to that, though, I got to ask you guys a favor, if this is okay. You guys know this is a podcast, right? So we put our sermons out as a podcast. And I just, you know, I'm preaching next week, and I don't have a ton of time. And I did this morning, but it didn't turn out. Is it okay if I do some ad reads? I got to record some ads for the podcast. Is that okay if I do that right now? I did it this morning in my sermon this morning, but they didn't turn out. Is that all right? Okay, all right. Well, let's jump into it then. Let's see here. What's the first one? Healing the city. Oh, yeah, okay. First one's healing the city. Great. This sermon is brought to you by the Healing the City podcast, which is, you know, it's a podcast, a ministry of the Village Church. We talk about theology and philosophy and psychology and the story of the village and the people in the village. This week on the podcast, we have an episode, a continuing series on being awkwardly vulnerable, where we talk about asking for help even when you don't need it and why that's important. And the other episode that's new this week is a John 14 remix, where we just tear apart Eric's sermon from last week. No, it was great. We say some really nice things about Eric's sermon. We talk through it. And then we go through some practical ways to fix our eyes on Jesus. So we talk about reading the gospel stories, asking where Jesus is in this moment, doing the things Jesus has told us to do, giving thanks day to day, and of course, a way to fix your eyes on Jesus is to pray. And all that and more on the Healing the City podcast, everywhere you get your podcasts. All right, great. Yeah, that went well, right? Cool. Yeah? Healing the City podcast? All right, cool. You know, those are good things. Maybe we'll come back to those later. Okay, I got one more here. Yeah, these aren't as present anymore, but you guys remember the on YouTube, they're the masterclass ads all the time, and you try to click skip as fast as you can. So I don't know if you know this, but I actually have a masterclass that I made, and I have an ad read for it. So there's me with Steph Curry and some other people who I don't recognize. I assume they're famous because it's masterclass, and this is my masterclass. So this sermon is also brought to you by masterclass. My masterclass, in fact, because if you didn't know, I am a master gardener. I am a fake master gardener. I have learned so much from listening to my wife talk about roses over the years. And in my masterclass, I tell you all the things that I have learned from my wife about roses over the years. So, thing number one we talk about in my masterclass, we talk about roots. The roots of roses are really important. Did you know that so you can order flowers, and you order them by the bloom, right? But certain blooms don't grow in certain places, and so they adapt those flowers and they graft them onto roots that will grow in your hot, dry environment. So roses that'll grow in your hot, dry environment, they take those roots and then they graft on the bloom that you kind of that you want to grow here. So I'll say, you know, you want to put those roots in a semi-permeable soil that's going to hold some water, but it's also going to let the water drain away so your roots aren't just sitting in soggy, wet soil, because then they'll get sick, and that's not good. And then, you know, you can feed your roses with liquid seaweed, which is disgusting. It smells really bad, but your plants love it. Right, Jesse? That's right. All right. Yeah, you're going to learn all about roots in my fake masterclass. Let's see here. You're also going to learn about types of roses. You got these blooms, different kinds of blooms. You know, you also have you have climbing roses and bush roses. Do you know that you can train your roses to grow along certain pathways? You can wrap them around like wires and stuff. I'll tell you all about that. That's about all I know, is that you wrap them around wires and they grow along there, and they climb. And if you have a bush rose and you want it to grow up, you want the flowers to kind of grow up and even, then you got to rotate it, because if you don't, the flowers will just grow straight towards the sun. And then they're all pointing the same way, away from where you want to sit. And so bush roses, types of roses, different types of roses. We're going to talk about that in my masterclass. And then, of course, the thing that's most important about roses is we're going to talk about pruning. We're going to talk about pruning your rose bush. And we're going to talk about canes. Rubbing canes. The canes of your rose bush that rub together, you don't want that. You don't want that. You want to cut that out. You want to take care of that. Because where those canes rub together, they're going to create disease and sores. And that's not good. It's not good for your rose. And then we're going to learn about sick leaves. Leaves that you want to pick them off. You want to make sure you get rid of those sick leaves, because they'll spread all the way across your rose bush. We're going to learn about clearing out your rose bush. Because did you know rose bushes, they just kind of grow in on themselves. And they get really, like, they block out the light for most of your rose bush. They block out the air can't come through. So you want to clear out your rose bush. And then we're going to learn about the yearly cutback. Then this is the most, I learned about this from my wife, I learned about it from my mom, I learned about it from my grandpa. You cut back roses to these canes, these just sticks that stick out of the ground, and they look like they're dead. And then the next year, they just come right back. This is my masterclass. This is what we're going to learn. I am fake master gardener Mark Crawford. You've just learned everything I know about roses. This is my masterclass. Hey, yeah, that went well, cool, yeah. Awesome, sweet. Thanks, guys. That's good. Maybe we'll come back to that. Maybe that'll be, I don't know, might be important for our sermon. Yeah, all right. So let's jump into John 15, because this is the last of the seven I am statements. I am the bread of life, the light of the world, the door of the sheep, the good shepherd, the resurrection and the life, the way, the truth, and the life. And this week, we are talking about the true vine. The true vine. Jesus says, I am the true vine. And so we're going to go through, we've finished up our I am statements, which are all about the identity of Jesus, who he says he is. And so we're going to jump into John chapter 15 to learn about the true vine. Starting in verse 1. I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me as I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If you do not remain in me, you are like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up and thrown into the fire and burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. Amen. So what's Jesus saying here? Well, on the one hand, he's saying a very plain reading of the scripture is that Jesus is the source of life. Jesus is the source of life. He is the vine and we are the branches. If we are connected into the vine, then we will grow. We will have life. We will bear fruit. We will be in him. As we bear fruit, we will bring more people into life, into the vine. And if we are cut off from the vine, if we cut ourselves off from the vine, then we will wither and die and be thrown away. Very plain reading. This is a good reading. Jesus is the source of life. He is the vine. But as we've gone through the seven I am statements, we found that they are more than just the plain reading, right? The same idea comes into when we talked about the bread of life, right? The bread of Jesus is the bread of life. As we wander in the desert, he is our light. If we stay with him, then we have bread, we have life. But we also learn that the bread of life connects back to the manna in the desert. When the people of God were wandering in the desert, he gave them manna to eat and he sustained them. And when they were wandering in the desert, he gave them a pillar of light and he was their light as they wandered. We connected the good shepherd back to Psalm 23. Jesus makes statements. The I am statements are not just the surface statement, all of which are good, but they all connect back to the reality of who Jesus is in Israel, in Israel's story, as the people of God. And so as we look at I am the true vine, I am the true vine is not any different. I am the true vine connects back to Psalm 80. Psalm 80, we're going to read starting in verse 8. You brought a vine out of Egypt. You drove out the nations and planted it. You cleared the ground for it, and it took root and filled the land. The mountains were covered with its shade, the mighty cedars with its branches. It sent out its boughs to the sea, its shoots as far as the river. Why have you broken down its walls so that all who pass by pick its grapes? Boars from the forest ravage it, and the creatures of the field feed on it. Return to us, O God Almighty. Watch down from heaven, look down from heaven and see. Watch over this vine, the root your right hand has planted, the sun you have raised up for yourself. Your vine is cut down, it is burned with fire. At your rebuke, your people perish. Let your hand rest on the man at your right hand, the Son of Man you have raised up for yourself. Then we will not turn away from you. Revive us, and we will call on your name. Restore us, O Lord God Almighty. Make your face shine upon us that we may be saved. The psalmist is calling out on behalf of the people of Israel. God had brought the people out of Egypt, planted them in the land. The vine had grown, the people of God had grown in the land, taken it, lived. But they had wandered. They had withered. And so the vine had been cut back. The vine had been cut back. The vine had been burned. People had come in and destroyed the land because they had wandered from God. So the psalmist cries out. He says, restore us. Restore us, O God. The root is here. Bring your Son who will restore us in this land. Jesus says, I am the vine and you are the branches. I am the true vine. I am the restoration of the people of God. This is the kingdom coming now. I am the one who is promised, the Son of God, who is going to reestablish the kingdom. And you are the branches. You are the branches. You are connected to me, and therefore you are the people of God. It's interesting that there's 12 disciples. He says, I am the vine, you are the branches, like the 12 tribes of Israel. Of course, one has gone off to betray Jesus, but you are the branches. If you bear fruit, if you remain in me, you will bear fruit. This is all about the kingdom of God. The kingdom of heaven come in Jesus. So if we are the people, if we are the branches, the people of God connected to him to produce fruit, then what is that kingdom like? Verse 9. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends. For everything I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. So that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. This is my command: love each other. Amen. This is what the kingdom's all about. Jesus says, remain in me and you will produce fruit. And what does it look like to remain in me, to remain in my love? Self-sacrificial love. This is not the romantic love, right? We talked about this before. It's not the romantic love. It's not the brotherly love. It's not the ethereal feeling. It is the self-sacrificial love. It is saying, I am going to set aside my own stuff, my own demands, my own desires, and I'm going to serve the person across from me. I am going to serve my brother, my sister in Christ. And Jesus has already set the example, right? He's already set the example. A few chapters ago, we looked at Jesus washing the feet of his disciples. He lowers himself to the lowest place, to the role of the servant, to care for his disciples, to wash their feet. And we can look forward to the sacrifice that Jesus will offer. The self-sacrifice in his love to offer himself for us. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. Now we, here and now, we are unlikely to be in a position where you will have to literally lay down your life to offer love to the person around you, to the person next to you. However, it does not mean that we do not have life that we can set aside to care for the other person. To not seek after ourselves, but to seek after the other person. This is the ethic of the kingdom. This is the way of the kingdom. This is what we are called to, is to set aside ourselves to care for the other. So what will the response be? Verse 18. If the world hates you, keep in mind that it hated me first. If you belong to the world, it would love you as its own. As it is, you do not belong to the world, but I have chosen you out of the world. That is why the world hates you. Remember what I told you, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you also. If they obeyed my teaching, they will obey yours also. They will treat you this way because of my name, for they do not know the one who sent me. If I had not come and spoken to them, they would not be guilty of sin. But now they have no excuse for their sin. Whoever hates me hates my Father as well. If I had not done among them the works no one else did, they would not be guilty of sin. As it is, they have seen, and yet they have hated both me and my Father. But this is to fulfill what is written in their law. They hated me without reason. Jesus here, if you've been in John with us, then you know that Jesus is calling back to earlier in John, calling back to him being rejected after the signs, the miracles, the things that he did, the things that he taught, and the response of the leaders. This passage is interesting because if you've been around the church for a while, it's probable that you've heard it preached as, well, if you go out into the world and you are a follower of Jesus, people will hate you because you are a follower of Jesus. And I want to offer a contradictory statement, because the first thing is that it's not about us. This passage, this is not about us. It's not about the idea of, well, I'm going to go out and I'm going to say I follow Jesus and then people are going to hate me. Because often it's used as an excuse, it's used as a way to excuse our own hate. The way we interact with the people around us, when we offer hate, what we receive back is hate. And then we say, well, no, it's okay because they hate me because I follow Jesus. It's not because of the mean thing I said about them. It's because I follow Jesus. And the reality is, this isn't about us. This is about the disciples. The disciples went out after Jesus was resurrected. They went out and began to teach about Jesus. They began to share about him. And those who persecuted Jesus persecuted them. And people listened to them and believed in Jesus. But almost every single one of the disciples died terrible deaths. They were persecuted because they proclaimed Jesus. And Jesus is telling them, the world will hate you. And here's the contradiction, is that this is also kind of about us. It is. The reality is that if we live into the ethic of the kingdom, if we live in self-sacrificial love, It is contrary to the ways of the world. The world is all about the self. How am I going to take care of myself? How am I going to live for myself? And if along the way I happen to care for some people around me, well, that's okay too, but it's about me. I have to take care of myself. I have to take care of my own things. And when we live into the self-sacrificial love, you will encounter contempt. The world hates Jesus. That is true. But I don't want us to use this as a way to excuse the way we interact with the world. Let us live into the ethic of the kingdom to offer self-sacrificial love. And so we come to the little tag at the end of John 15. When the Advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth, who goes out from the Father, he will testify about me, and you also must testify, for you have been with me from the beginning. I will just say a couple things briefly about this. First, today is Pentecost, which is the day when we remember the coming of the Holy Spirit in Acts. As the followers of Jesus are gathered together, the Holy Spirit comes and they begin to preach and teach and testify to the name of Jesus, which is what Jesus says will happen. You will testify about me. And we're going to talk, I wish we were talking about John 16 this week because it's Pentecost, because John 16 next week is actually a lot more about the Holy Spirit. We're going to get to that. But I just want to remind us of what Eric said last week, which is the work of the kingdom. The work of Jesus' followers is to testify to his name. Our purpose as his created beings is to worship him. The work that we have been given by Jesus is to testify to his name, to love each other and to proclaim his name. Amen? Amen. So, what lingers? What lingers? There's so much in this passage, and I kept coming back to this, like, so what do I do? What do we do with this passage? What lingers? Well, the first thing for me that kept coming back is this phrase, remain in me. For obvious reasons, it's all over. It's all over the passage. Remain in me. And here's part of the reason why this kept coming back to me is I don't like this word. You might have a different reading of this, but I don't like the word remain. It gives me the feeling of, hey, stay. Like, stay here, stay there. You know, like I'm going to like attach a leash like a dog and say, sit, stay. Right? Remain in me. Don't wander off and go find other things. Stay here. Remain. That's the feeling I kept getting as I was coming through this week. And then, so I was going through, reading some other translations. And the other word that's often used for this passage is abide. Abide, which is a beautiful word. I love the word abide. But when was the last time you used the word abide and you weren't reading John 15? The dude abides. Yes. We don't use this word. We don't use the word abide. It's a beautiful word, but we don't use the word abide. So I kept coming back to this idea of dwell. It's the same idea. It's an alternate translation of this word, to dwell. To dwell in Jesus. To live in Jesus. To dwell with him. And I kept thinking about it, to dwell with Jesus, to be in the mobile home, to be the mobile home of Jesus, right? That was what we talked about last week, to be the mobile home. If we are in Jesus, then we are the mobile home. We have the Holy Spirit and Jesus, and we are living, and the Father, and we are living with him. We are the mobile home of Jesus. To dwell with him, to be able to, you know, be driving along and turn around and say, Jesus, would you like some eggs? I'm making them in the kitchen, right? This is we're moving along with Jesus, to dwell with him. And so as we recorded this podcast on healing the city this week, fix your eyes on Jesus. This was the question from last week. What does it mean to fix your eyes on Jesus? And this is really, fix your eyes on Jesus. It's really just dwell with Jesus, to live with Jesus. What does it mean to live with Jesus, to dwell in him? And it's this, to dwell in Jesus is to read the gospel stories. Read the Bible. Read the gospel stories. Read the words of Jesus. Know what he did. Know what he said. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, read them. They're not long. Read them. Read the gospel stories. Ask, where is Jesus? Because as we go about our day, we don't know where Jesus is. He's in the corner reading a book. He's like out in space. He's at my neighbor's house. I don't know. Turn around and ask, where is Jesus right now? He's in the mobile home with you. He's right there next to you. Just ask, where is Jesus? And then do the things that Jesus has told us to do. This is my command. Love each other. Live out the kingdom ethic. Give thanks day to day for the things that we have, and pray. To dwell with Jesus is to spend time in prayer. To talk with him. To share your day with him. That was the first thing that kept coming back to me. Remain in me. Dwell with me. The second thing that kept coming back to me is pruning. Pruning. And specifically with pruning, I kept coming back to these ideas. The gardener is the Father. The vine is Jesus, and we are its branches. And he said the gardener is going to come and prune the vine. So what does it look like if the gardener is going to come prune in your life? So here's a few ideas, and I would like to hold on to this in a spirit of confession, just as Adrian beautifully shared earlier. In a spirit of confession, as we look at these ideas, where is the Father, where is the gardener coming along to prune in your life? So the rubbing canes, the canes of the rosebush rub together and create spots where disease starts, it festers, it hurts the rosebush. What are those places in your life? The rubbing together, these are places of contempt, right? Contempt is cold anger. It's anger that lingers. Contempt, where are the places of contempt? Where are the places of bitterness in your life? The things that keep coming back, the places of anger that you cannot get rid of. Where is the bitterness? Where is the contempt in your life? The places where your soul is rubbing up against it again and again. And then the sick leaves. The sick leaves are the practices that we have that we know we need to get rid of. The practices that we have that we know we need to get rid of. The practices that are not good for us. They're not healthy for us. They're not healthy for the people around us. This is a lot of our addictions. Our addictions to alcohol and drugs and pornography. Our addictions to exercise. Our addictions to our couch. To the apps on our phone. These are the things we know they're there. And we know they're not good for us. But we keep going back to them. What are the leaves that the gardener wants to come along and pick out? And I think these first two, as we think about them, as we think about the places of bitterness, the places of contempt, the practices we engage in that we know we need to get rid of, those are kind of easy for us to see. They're signs that those are there. The clearing out is a little bit more interesting because the clearing out is just the rose bush becomes overgrown and the light cannot get in and the air cannot get in and it becomes place. There's more potential for things like sick leaves and rubbing canes. And this is just the busyness of our lives. We are busy. We do not have space to dwell with Jesus because everything is filled up. The light cannot penetrate because we have too many things. Where is Jesus inviting you to set things aside? What is the pruning, the cutting back that Jesus wants, that God, the Father, that the gardener wants to do? Then we have this yearly cutback. And the yearly cutback, you just it cuts down to the... This one's a little harder for us. This feels like a season of death. When you cut back a rose, it looks like there's nothing there. There's just these sticks sticking up out of the ground. And these are seasons that we enter into, and sometimes we don't even know that we're entering into it. And the gardener has cut us all the way back. These are seasons of grief, pain, struggle. We're feeling seasons of dryness, of feeling like I read my Bible and I don't get anything. I pray and I just don't feel like God is around. I don't know what to do. And they're not yearly, right? Sometimes they're short seasons, sometimes they're long seasons, years-long seasons where we don't know what to do. And it feels like death. But the vine is still there. The root is still there. Jesus is still there. There is still life in the root. We are still in those seasons called to dwell in Jesus. To dwell in the life that is in Jesus. And to read the stories and to ask Jesus, where are you? I don't know where you are. To continue to live into the kingdom ethic. To love, to give thanks, and to pray. So, with that, where is the gardener pruning in your life? What are ways that you need to live into dwelling with Jesus, dwelling in Him, and acting out the kingdom ethic of love? Amen. Amen. A few minutes, a couple minutes, if anyone would like to say anything. There is one right there.
Thank you for your sermon. I was a little confused at the beginning. But I'll ask you about that later. The thing that just keeps coming back to me is Daniel last week in the morning service confessed. Like, I just love how you say, do the thing that he told you to do. And the places where I get contempt or bitterness, especially in parenting, is when I don't see outcomes. And so I think that's a huge area that, like, if you're getting pruned back, releasing the outcome and just abiding with Jesus, I really feel that invitation. The other thing I really love about abiding with Jesus is I was talking to a child in my life, and they said, what does it mean when the pastors say you are invited to take communion if you can say that you side with Jesus or if you stand with Jesus? They said, is this about being physically able to say it? Because everyone could say it. And I was like, no, it's about faith. It's about saying that you are choosing to say that Jesus is your king and your savior. And they said, I can't always say that. Sometimes it doesn't feel true. And I just think the faith of children, because then we got to talk about, yes, it's not going to always feel true. And so you're saying, I believe, like you're saying, like Peter, where else will we go? That's why that was up there. And so I guess I just feel your invitation when we get cut back to continue to say, I will abide and I will stay with Jesus, though I have no fruit. It's a really beautiful invitation, so I thank you.
Yeah.
So recently I was told that I'd be moving from the middle school to an elementary school in our district, which was kind of a shock. And I was really mad about it, and I kept listening to this song over and over and over again. And it's funny because I'll be one of the people to say, I listen to songs without hearing the words, you know, so I can get away with listening to bad songs sometimes. But in this case, it wasn't a bad song. It was a song by Ren Collective. And so I finally stopped. I couldn't figure out why I kept listening to it. And then I stopped and sort of heard the lyrics. And it starts with, take every treasure, take this life. Everything's on the altar now. No holding back, no holding out. In view of your matchless sacrifice, take every treasure, take this life. All that I am for all that you are. And it goes on. It's a really good song. I recommend it. All That I Am is what it's called. But I realized, we can look at situations in our life in a variety of ways, but I think when we have situations that come up that are out of our control, it's easier for me to just believe that it's God's plan, that I'm intended to move to an elementary school that's nowhere, has nothing to do with where we live or my children. It's like, doesn't make any sense at all to me, but to believe that my talents and what I do isn't about me anyway. And so to listen to a song like that on repeat, to believe that, to remain in God's truth, is kind of like how we survive these types of circumstances. And I'm hoping for outcome because then it'll feel worth it, but I can't control that either, you know? So I think it's like what gives you hope is outcome. But, when it doesn't come, then you find a new journey of faith and you wrestle through that too, I think. So anyways.
Yeah. Thanks, Adrian.
So, I just resonate a lot with this pruning stuff based on some plant things that have happened with us recently. But, I'll say, first of all, the pruning, when that happens, it's, startling to see when someone comes and, trims your bougainvillea or rose bushes down, the way they're supposed to. It's just, this little stump of a plant. And you're what happened to it? Is it okay? But then, it does grow back. But it takes time. I think that's the first thing to say. And then I was thinking about that and our lemon tree that pretty much broke in half. And we had to call, the arborist to come out and figure out what to do with it. And they pruned, a huge part of the tree is missing that I did not think they were going to do. So it was startling to have that cut off. But he did his thing. He fixed it up because he knew what it's doing. But it won't recover and for 3 to 5 years.
Yeah.
So it takes a lot of time. And I think that's the other part of this. All these things that happen, but it's not instant. There is grief you have to go through. There's this wrestling with yourself as you have to adjust with these things. But it's not that happened today. I did it. I got pruned, and now No, it's there. Yeah. It's going to take a while before it's back to where it's supposed to be.
Yeah.
Just want to add, like, invite the expert and trust the expert. Really.
Well,
I think that's what this is about.
This week I kept thinking, so I drive with my wife in the car a lot, and she says things like, oh no, look at how they pruned that bush. Right, just like at like the bank, we're like driving by, and there's the bank, and there's some bushes outside, and they're like, you say that too. She's like, what are they doing? Oh no. And the interesting thing is that there's certain bushes where if you like, they like to just like and like shave the outside. But if you do it again and again and again, what happens to the bush is it gets really woody, and eventually you shave off the top of it, and all you don't get any leaves growing back because it's just this woody block because it hasn't had anywhere to grow because you haven't actually gone in and pruned the bush. And the hope in this is that the Father, I am not the master gardener. The Father is the master gardener, and the Father knows what he's doing. And if we abide in Jesus, the Father comes and prunes. And it does hurt sometimes. And it is painful. But it is good to sit with Jesus and to allow the master gardener to do his work. Bentley, did you want to say something?
Mom's just singing, she's staying in Esburg Middle School, and she's moving to Kingfield for working for the kids. Mm-hmm. And up the screen, I like the piece of the mug beard.
Thanks. Mm-hmm. Thanks, Bentley. All right, one more over here, and then we will close.
I just want to stand up for the word remain. I think that it is the word that was supposed to be there. I think it reminds me of the verse, I don't remember what book it's in, but it's like a pig who goes right from the bath mm-hmm. to the mud. Mm-hmm. And the verse right before he says remain is like, you're already clean mm-hmm. because of the words I've spoken to you. And so you would want, he's like, remain in me. And I think he's not leashing us. He's giving us the choice to be with him. And so how else are we supposed to show him that we're with him rather than like, yeah, I guess we don't have the leash. So we have to stand by his side and actually stay with him without the leash.
I love it. Thanks, Kelly. One of my favorite lines in any song is in Come Thou Fount, where it says, what is it? Bind my... prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. He says, with like a fetter. A fetter is a leash. It's one of my favorite lines. We are tied to Jesus, but he does invite us to remain in goodness like a fetter. Bind my wandering heart to thee. That's what it is. Yep. Thank you. Let's pray. Jesus, thank you for your love. Thank you for showing us the way of love, for inviting us into being in you. Father, would you come as the master gardener and prune the places that need to be pruned? Would you give us hearts to see you, to know you better? And Holy Spirit, would you comfort us in the midst of it? Would you give us peace? Give us joy. In your name I pray. Amen.